Bonjour tout le monde. Vous êtes les bienvenus, chers amis, amis de l'Institut. I suppose it's true to say that this session of the Institute could well and aptly be called Thinking the Unthinkable. The unthinkable being, of course, for most of us anyway, the election of Marine Le Pen to be president of France. What worries me basically is the number of people in France who have said to me that this is impossible. Where did we hear that before? And quite recently. And in my case, including from the American ambassador. So in the case of the US elections. It's true that in 2002, Marine's very controversial father, Jean-Marie, was stopped from becoming president by the Socialist Party joining forces with the right in the second round to elect the Gaullist Jacques Chirac. And it was Lionel Jospin who had been the Socialist candidate. However, we have a very different France 14 years on. And this has been a very different campaign. We have a France still defiant, of course, still a great republic, but demoralized after a quinquennat, 5 years, of socialist rule under one of the most unpopular presidents, I think, Lara, and it's true to say, the most unpopular president ever, and the first not to run for a second term. France, unlike its neighbor, Germany, which it watches with not a small amount of envy, I have to say, having been there recently, has suffered much from the recent recession and is only now beginning to come out of it, but still with high unemployment, particularly amongst the young. In agriculture, which is such a central part of French life, not particularly an economic center, that as well, but a cultural center, a historical center. Most French people very emotionally involved. And there is devastation in the countryside and in villages, and a high result resulting in a high level of suicides among agriculture. There is a growing disaffection with Europe, not only in France, of course, as being the cause of, or of at least some of its ills. There is an urgent need to reform French public life, as we all know, and perhaps in France a willingness, but not among those who would be the most affected, mainly public servants. There is a large swathe of the French people who are now switched off from traditional politics, particularly on the left, who feel abandoned and have now turned towards the Front National as being their last and only hope. There is huge disaffection, of course, also on the right, who see life in France changing beyond what they are prepared to put up with. And I'm talking, I suppose, mainly about immigration. And of course, there is terrorism and the ongoing threat thereof. And of course, how can anyone forget? We all forget, of course, by times, but how can any person in France forget Paris, the attack, attentat, or Nice? And even the less spectacular horrors, such as the elderly priest dying in a small village by having his throat cut on his own, the church of his own altar, of his, the altar of his own church. But a few months ago, the forever resilient French Republic was settling down for the upcoming election campaign and a change of president, which most people, even on the left, were fairly sure that it would come from the right. Francois Fillon presented a radical plan for reform, a right-wing plan, but nevertheless a plan that people found credible. And Fillon had survived his years as Sarkozy's prime minister relatively unscathed, I think would be the term.
I think he carries the scars, actually.
And that is a feat in itself. And a practicing Catholic, he had the credentials and the what the French call probably l'allure présidentielle. They look for l'allure, the
aura.
Thank you. So he had a lot of things going for him. And he was the one who was expected to win, certainly hands down, against Marine Le Pen. And he was a safe pair of hands. And then disaster struck. And it struck in a strange way. It struck through on the pages, the front pages of this magazine, this newspaper, which many of you will be familiar with, the Canard Enchaîné, in all three of these that I happen to have. I'll auction them off afterwards if you like. But the accusations and the proof, indeed, of how he had defrauded the state totally changed things. And we don't know how much it has changed things. But today we have two eminent observers of France. And to talk to us more about the campaign, and especially what might be the denouement of this, the denouement of all this, which has incredible serious implications for the French people in the first place, of course, but also for the people of Europe. And that, I don't think, is an exaggeration, and I'm sure John will talk about that. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce Lara, who, no stranger to the Institute, I'm sure you've heard her before, some of you. And she's been a journalist for 30-odd years. She's worked in Washington, Paris, obviously, and the Middle East. She is an incredibly, I've said this before about her, incredibly versatile journalist, because she can turn her hand to any story as far as I can see and judge. But she has been reporting assiduously and particularly well on this French campaign. She's obviously, she has had several awards in her time, and of course one of them being the Légion d'honneur. So, Lara, with that in mind, we'll allow you to have the floor. Thank you.
The last time that I spoke to the Institute in the beginning of November 2014, I fear I told you that Alain Juppé would be the next president of France. So I got it wrong, but everybody else got it wrong, too. He was just flying in the polls. He was very, very high, and no one just imagined how Juppé could be defeated. What has happened is what Jean-Luc Mélenchon, one of the four leading finalists, calls dégagisme, which dégager means get lost, basically. And he took the term from the Tunisians who overthrew Ben Ali in Tunisia. And in the last sort of 6 months or so, we've seen Sarkozy. Basically, everyone thought that everyone feared that this presidential election would be a contest between Nicolas Sarkozy and Francois Fillon. That was the sort of worst case scenario, as we would have a replay of the 2012 election. Well, Sarkozy came in third, as you know, in Les Républicains primary. And Hollande was so unpopular, he had to pull out in December. But other people have been victims of this dégagisme as well. Juppé, because he's too associated with the past. And even Manuel Valls, who was a great hope of many socialists, of the sort of more liberal, centrist, Jacques Delors-style socialist. So all of these people have been eliminated. And in fact, the two of the most powerful arguments against leading candidates are against Fillon, because he was prime minister for 5 years under Sarkozy, so he's associated with the past and with the establishment. And even Macron, who was an advisor, economic advisor to Hollande, and then, of course, economy minister under Hollande. Nothing is certain. I thought a very good analogy, which I got from a pollster on Friday, was that he said, in the past, a French presidential election campaign was a bit like a Mondrian painting. You know, it was all lines and boxes, and you could sort of analyze it and figure it out. And he says, this is a Jackson Pollock painting. You know, paint just squirted every which way. And so in recent weeks, we've kind of settled into the idea that Marine Le Pen will come in first, probably in the first round on April 23rd, and Emmanuel Macron will come in second, and then they would go on to the runoff on May 7th, and Macron would just wipe out Marine Le Pen, and the polls show he would win by 60% to 40% approximately for Le Pen. But in the last two or three days, one thing, the most significant thing I think that's happened is Jean-Luc Mélenchon, who's very far left, has overtaken François Fillon. He's now in third place, and he has real momentum. He's siphoning off all the votes that were going to Benoît Hamon, the socialist candidate. So he and Fillon Fillon's at 17% in a poll published today, Mélenchon at 18%, but they're almost within reaching distance of Macron and Le Pen, who are tied at 24%. So anything could happen, and there could be a terrorist attack, there could be another big scandal, a sexual scandal or a financial scandal. It's really impossible to predict what is going to happen. So it's a four-way race. I think I'll just sort of go through very briefly in order of probability, okay? If we're just based on the polls at present, the most probable next president of France is Emmanuel Macron, who, as you know, is only 39 years old. That would make him the youngest ever president of France. He has a lot going for him. He's young, he's good looking, he has charisma. He has a very unusual love story, which I'm sure you all know about. His wife, Brigitte, is 24 years older than him. She was his drama teacher when he was 16 years old. He fell in love with her. Eventually, she was married with three children. His parents did everything they could to thwart this romance, sent him to Paris to live with his grandmother, and love triumphed, and he married Brigitte in 2007, and she's very much present in the wings of his campaign. Macron has a very broad appeal. He basically appeals to the more centrist socialist, the center, and the more centrist right-wing people. For example, a lot of Alain Juppé's voters went to Macron after Juppé was excluded. His emphasis on renewal of the political class and on bringing civil society into politics, getting rid of career politicians, is also very popular. The factors that are working against him are that his base of support is very undecided. About half of his supporters say they're not certain that they would vote for him in the second round. And that's compared to Le Pen, who's got 86% of her voters say they will vote for her come hell or high water, no matter what. And Fillon has also a pretty strong base. About 70% of his supporters say they're certain to vote for him. Another factor working against Macron is his association with François Hollande. who, you know, as Joe said, is the most unpopular president ever in France. And he was very much an Hollande protégé. I know for a fact that Hollande is secretly hoping, or not that secretly, it's good, the word has got around, but he's hoping that Macron will win. He sees Macron as his sort of spiritual son. And Macron does not want Hollande's public support. It could be the kiss of death for him. The Fillon camp has taken to calling, referring to Macron as Emmanuel Hollande, which is very damaging. Now, another problem for Macron is he's actually I hate to say, minus the good looks and the charm, he's very much like Hollande in his rhetoric. France 2 on Thursday night had a big interview with him. And they put together a montage of him saying, en même temps, you know, at the same time. So he'll say, well, you know, it is a beautiful day in Dublin today, but en même temps, at the same time, we have rain clouds, you know. And he does this constantly. And, for example, his response to the chemical attack in Syria, he said, Bashar al-Assad must no longer be in the game. But I don't agree with the people who want to eradicate him. Well, what does that mean? He can't be involved, but you don't want to eradicate him. Or every problem that comes up, every issue, Macron has the on the one hand, on the other hand. And this drives people crazy. And Marine Le Pen, in the first debate, said, just listened to him talking, and said, you've been speaking for 7 minutes, and I couldn't possibly summarize what you've said. She said, you know, you say a little of this and a little of that, and it's just, it's meaningless. And that was quite damaging. And then actually in the second debate, there was a similar comment by a sort of one of these maverick candidates, a little candidate called Asselineau, who said, but you always agree with everybody. You know? And this was Hollande's legacy. Hollande was the l'homme de la synthèse, the man who always arrives at a consensus. And that's how he held the Socialist Party together. So people are a little bit leery of this side of Macron that is kind of flu, kind of blurry, kind of all over the place. That is hurting him. On his policies, I think the most important policy of Macron is his pro-Europeanism. He is the only real defender of Europe in this campaign. He loves Europe. He says, I love Europe. And he wants, and I thought, I was kind of surprised because I thought it had totally gone out of fashion. It was finished forever. He wants European integration. He wants a federal Europe. He wants to create more European institutions. He wants countries to give up. He's against intergovernmental Europe. He says it's dead. And that's his biggest difference with Fillon, because Fillon wants the continuation of these summits of heads of state who churn out the communiques and so on. He also wants to relaunch the Franco-German engine. He wants to reform the labor market. Actually, most of his policies are quite similar to Fillon's policies, but I would call them Fillon light. You know, instead of firing 500,000 civil servants, he wants to get rid of 120,000 civil servants. Instead of Fillon wants to abolish the wealth tax, the ESF, the Impôt sur la Fortune, and Macron says, well, I'll abolish it on stocks and bonds and shares and capital investments, but I won't, but I'll keep it on property. That's another example of him doing, always balancing. He always does the balancing act. And I was very struck. I'm reading two books right now, one about Montretout, which is the family chateau of the Le Pens, which is actually very amusing, and a more serious book by Macron, which was called Révolution, which is his sort of manifesto. And it's very interesting, the character difference. He and Marine Le Pen, who are likely again to be adversaries, are complete opposites, because Le Pen goes on about how she's persecuted, how everyone is out to get her, she's a victim, and so on and so forth. And when you read Macron's book, for example, he never mentions that his parents tried to keep him away from Brigitte and sent him to be raised by his grandmother. It's just, everyone is wonderful in his book. He likes everyone. He's lisse, as the French say. He's smooth, you know, and he's positive, he's cheerful. Pollsters say that the most important determinant between Macron and Le Pen voters is whether you're an optimist or a pessimist. And if you're an optimist, you vote for Macron. And if you're a pessimist, you vote for Marine Le Pen. And this is even more, it's also a social class vote, because the more educated, affluent people tend to are voting for Macron. In fact, and that's something else that hurts him. He's seen as the candidate of the bankers, the candidate of the elite. And I hear people say all the time, "Ah, c'est l'homme des banquiers," you know, and that hurts in France. But if I had a pollster told me on Friday, if you're a working class person, you would probably vote for Le Pen, except if you're an optimistic worker, in which case you would vote for Macron. And if you're affluent, if you're earning a good living, you should be voting for Macron, unless you are very pessimistic. If you think the country is going to the dogs and that it's being destroyed by immigration and Islam, you will vote for Le Pen, despite the fact that you're affluent. So I thought that was very, very telling. I'll go very quickly. I mean, Fillon, he's at 17%. He looks and acts, sounds presidential. When you hear him speak, you think, wow, you know, he's imposing. He's playing on experience, also on the thirst on the French right for what they call alternance. And I'm not really satisfied with any translations I found of alternance. It's a change, but it's also in France we've had left, right, left, right, left, right, and they alternate in power. And the right feels it's their turn to come back to power. And what's happening, and I can see it around me, is a lot of them are disgusted with Fillon, and they're with good reason, because of the fake job scandal and the free suits for 50,000 euro and so on. They think he's a crook, but they say if it's him or a continuation of Hollande or Marine Le Pen, we're going to vote for Fillon. And I know people who had decided not to vote for Fillon who've now have come back to the idea because they like his economic policies, because they think the country really needs to be reformed and shaken up. So that could, it's not impossible that he could win still. And it would be, by the way, this election will be the first where we will have had not one, but two candidates who are mis en examen, which is basically you have been charged with corruption, both Fillon and Marine Le Pen, although she refuses to answer the judge's summons. Two of the four leading candidates, and Fillon's wife, Penelope, as well. Fillon is compared to Margaret Thatcher, and he seems to be several decades behind the times, but he really wants to enforce rigor and austerity and totally reform the economy. Mélenchon, who's made this amazing breakthrough, his party is called La France Insoumise, France Unbowed. He's a Trotskyist. He's changed a lot since the last campaign when I was studying your colleagues over lunch. In 2012, he admired Hugo Chavez, and now he talks about General de Gaulle. In 2012, he played the Internationale at his rallies, and now he plays La Marseillaise and so on. He has a chance as well. If Mélenchon wins, he wants a 100 billion euro investment plan. He's going to borrow to finance it. And he wants to 173 billion euro in new expenditure. So basically, Fillon and Macron want to reform the economy, they want to save money, and Le Pen and Mélenchon both want to spend a lot. Mélenchon, by the way, had a rally in the port of Marseille last night. He had 70,000 people show up. So he's really the man who's got the momentum at the moment is Mélenchon. Marine Le Pen, I can't not say something about Marine Le Pen. It's a paradox that she is the most popular. The Front National is actually the leading party by all opinion polls. She's getting 25-30% in elections in recent years, but she will still lose because there's a sort of glass ceiling. There's a deeply entrenched aversion to the extreme right, and everyone believes that this will kick in and that she won't do more than she might get 40. She might get. Do better than expected, maybe 45% in the second round. But very few people believe that she will actually win, although we're all nervous. So working against her is this feeling. Also, she made an unfortunate comment yesterday. She said the French were not responsible for the Veldive You know, the big roundup of Jews in Paris during the Second World War, which Chirac was the first president to admit that this had been the fault of the French. And then she kind of did a lot of backpedaling and said, no, she said, I believe, like General de Gaulle believed, that the true France was in London with General de Gaulle, and the people who did that were not really French, and so on and so forth. So she's backpedaling, but that's hurt her. And it also reminds people of the sort of neo-fascist foundation of the Front National, and also the fact that she has neo-Nazis in her immediate close circle. Guys like Frédéric Chatillon, who used to celebrate Hitler's birthday and send condolence notes to each other on you know, the anniversary of his death. And I've been surprised that hasn't got too much attention so far, but her remark about the Veldiv could. She also has problems with her old father, who every once in a while makes an unfortunate remark, and with her niece, who is a competitor, really, who's very attractive, who's further to the right for Marine. And if the Front National doesn't win this time, they could win in 2022, and it could be Marion Maréchal Le Pen instead of Marine. And as you know, Marine's policies on, I think, if she's elected, it's the end of Europe as we know it. I just don't see how Europe could survive. She wants to leave the euro. You know all that. A few points, and I'll summarize here. The fact that three out of four leading candidates are pro-Russian, close to Putin. Mélenchon, Fillon, and Le Pen all prefer Russia to the United States. Well, with Donald Trump in office, that's poor Emmanuel Macron is sort of left out on a branch because he is pro-American, but he doesn't have any affinity for Donald Trump. And then another question is the future of the Socialist Party. If neither makes it to the runoff, the two French political families that have ruled since the Second World War will be more or less finished. The big question about the legislative elections, if Le Pen or Macron, or probably Macron, wins in June, can they get a parliamentary majority and to carry out their programs?
John O'Brien, who's Jean Monnet, professor of European integration in Maynooth. He's obviously published a lot on Europe and integration, has spoken in many places, including in the Institute, I think, here. And he now joins us to talk about the implications of all of this, and I think they are serious from what you've gathered, for Europe and where Europe, I suppose, is going in any case.
Yes, well, thank you very much indeed, Joe, and thank you for the invitation. And it's a pleasure to share my speaking time with Lara, whose work I've been reading, like many of you, for a very long time. Now, I just have 10 minutes or so I just want to throw out, I think, what might be the most important issues that link the French presidential election with European integration in general. I think it goes without saying that the French presidential election is truly existential for the EU, where Brexit is a minor irritation. It's going to absorb a lot of negotiating energy and time, perhaps, over the next few years, unless the talks break down very quickly, which they might. But the prospect of a Frexit is truly existential because it portends the disintegration of the European Union. And whereas I think up till recently, the chief concern in Brussels and in national capitals was about, obviously, the prospect of a Le Pen victory. The extraordinary momentum behind Mr. Mélenchon over the last week, I think, is also giving Brussels pause for thought. And the nightmare prospect, I think, is of a runoff between Le Pen and Mélenchon. And as Lara said, given where they are respectively in the polls and the climb that Mélenchon has made after the last televised debate last week, it is not out of the question that it could be Le Pen-Mélenchon, even if it seems much more likely at this point in time that it will be a runoff between Le Pen and Macron. And obviously the European Union has a real interest in this result. It was extraordinary, I think, to see the European Commission enter the fray in the French general election by setting up a fact-checking operation that was deliberately put in place to try and counter some of the lies, mischaracterizations, and so on that the Le Pen campaign was deploying. Now, this election, I think, comes at a critical time, obviously, because it's one of a series of hugely important elections in Europe this year that will culminate with the German election in September. With all due apologies to the Czech ambassador, the Czech election comes a little bit later. But it is, of course, the French and German elections that will decide the future direction of the integration process. Now, I think, however, we should pay attention to some of the most recent electoral contests that we have seen, where the evidence suggests that the wave of populism that has engulfed Europe in recent years may well have peaked. You may remember in the Austrian presidential election, the far-right candidate was defeated when it was expected that he could well win. In Bulgaria, most recently, the center parties, that is, GERB on the center-right and the Socialist Party on the left, emerged as the two largest parties, and GERB will most likely form a centrist coalition of some kind. In the Netherlands, Geert Wilders' seemingly unstoppable rise to the top was halted, and it looks like he has very little prospect of being part of a coalition. And in Germany, I think it's worth noting also that Mrs. Merkel, who seemed to have fallen behind the SPD once Martin Schulz emerges as her challenger, actually did very well in the Saarland Länder election last Sunday week. And again, there, the interesting comparison can be made between the AfD, the Alternative for Deutschland, and the Front National. Both of those parties seem to be flatlining in terms of their overall level of support over the last 6 months, where they had seemed to have real momentum over the previous year to 18 months. So I think there is a view in Europe, a sense of quiet expectation, if you like, rather than trepidation, which was there previously. But I think the worrying thing in the French case, which Lara has pointed to, is the potential collapse in the centrist vote. If, for example, Les Républicains and the Socialists, if you put their combined votes together and they drop to third and fourth or fourth and fifth place, which is very conceivable in this election, then we will have further evidence of the collapse in the centrist vote in these hugely important jurisdictions in Europe. But of course, that's contradicted by the fact that Macron is a centrist. And if he wins, it will be a triumph for the centre as much as anything else. Secondly, just to speak briefly about the French parliamentary elections, which will follow the presidential elections in June, I think these are going to be absolutely critical, because if Macron wins, it will inevitably be some form of cohabitation regime that emerges. His movement, the En Marche movement, is a very new one. A lot of his candidates come from outside of mainstream or traditional party politics. It's very difficult to say how they will actually do, how many seats they will win in Parliament. But it's very likely that he's going to have to assemble some form of coalition in order to be able to govern. So will we get an operable coalition in France? From the European perspective, instability would be certainly not as bad as a win for Le Pen or Mélenchon, but it's something that will complicate, I think, the effort to repurpose European integration at the same time, remember, as the Brexit talks are ongoing. So I think the clear desire in most European capitals, obviously, is for a win for Emmanuel Macron. And that opens up possibilities. As Lara said, Macron is, for all the wishy-washiness, there is a commitment to European integration and federalism, which is rather a novelty these days in centrist politicians of the right or left. Federalism is one of those things that is just not embraced in the same way that it was previously in different European jurisdictions. But I just wanted to take up Lara's point about Macron's opposition to intergovernmentalism. There, I think we might run into a problem, because if Mrs. Merkel is re-elected and she remains as committed to what she calls the union method of governing, which is to privilege what goes on in the Council and the European Council, and Macron's idea of Europe is very different in that he embraces a strong role for the Commission and the traditional community supranational structures, then I think we could be running into a potential conflict between France and Germany. However, it is much more likely that we're going to see the reanimation or the repurposing, if you like, of the entire European integration process. There's a space, if you like, potentially opening up that hasn't been there probably since the 1980s that will allow for a rethinking of the European Union, a rethinking of its institutions and its purpose in the early 21st century. Are we likely to see a big leap forward? What kind of initiatives might emerge? Well, I know there is some hope to attach to the view that a progressive alliance might be possible, that if Monsieur Macron wins in France and if Martin Schulz were to trump, so to speak, Merkel in Germany in September, that will allow for a rethinking of European integration along progressive lines. And this would be very different to the kind of Blairite approach to Europe. Macron, of course, is compared very often to Blair for very obvious reasons. But Blair was never a federalist. He was never really much of a supporter of the European integration process. So I think it's probably more likely that we would see a progressive kind of Europe emerge if it's Macron-Schulz. But even if Mrs. Merkel is re-elected, I think she's going to have more space in which to be able to operate than she has had over the last number of years. I think we're going to see a very different approach to Turkey, for example, in time. And given Brexit and given the election of Donald Trump, I'm sure that in her mind, the reanimation of the integration process is hugely important. Now, what form might that take? Well, as yet, it's very unclear. I've been struck in the aftermath of the publication of the recent white paper of just how similar it is to all of the debates that were going on during and around the Constitutional Convention in 2005. All of that argument about variable geometry, about the potential move to a core Europe, and that France and Germany, of course, would lead that, and that that in itself would act as a catalyzing force. All those things are back in play, of course. But the one thing is missing, I think, is any focus on deprivation, on welfare, on the extraordinary problems in Southern Europe in particular, of unemployment and the link between that and the delegitimation of the European integration process. I see no evidence that in Brussels that that has been taken seriously enough. And finally, just to deal with Russia, because Lara mentioned that three of the four main candidates are in one way or another what might be perceived as pro-Russian. That will present a problem, I think, because the European The European Union's regime of sanctions against the Russian Federation has been difficult enough to preserve in the aftermath of the election of Trump in the United States. I think it's going to be more difficult, notwithstanding all of the difficulties that he faces in Washington about those relations. But I think that's definitely a space to watch, that the relationship between Russia and the European Union to some extent is a prisoner of the Russian-Washington relationship, of course. But obviously, again, here, the election of Macron would make things much easier for a coordinated European response to be maintained than if Mélenchon-Le Pen or Fillon was to win. Thank you very much indeed.